Hey everyone, I think we're gonna get started. First of all, welcome to today's panel, which is Mobilized by Memories, Countering Incarceration Culture. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to be here with us. We're so excited for this amazing group of panelists who I will introduce briefly shortly. To get some housekeeping out of the way first, we do have live captioning. To turn it on, all you have to do is go down to the menu bar at the bottom of the screen, click live transcript, and then click show subtitle, and you should be able to see live captioning for all of our panelists. If you missed any of these instructions, we also dropped those instructions in the chat as well. Second of all, we will be recording the event and sending out a link to everyone who has RSVP'd. So if a friend couldn't make it tonight, let them know that they will be getting an email shortly with the recording. So no fear. And number three, we have our chat open and our Q&A box open. So please feel free to drop any questions or comments for our panelists throughout the event. We'll do our best to get to them at the end of the discussion. And lastly, in terms of the format for today's panel, each of our panelists will speak for 5 minutes on their work, and then we'll devote most of our time to a discussion and a Q&A portion led by our moderator, Umi. Okay, so today's panel is co-presented by One Archives at USC, the One Archives Foundation, and In Plain Sight. The One Archives at the USC Library is the largest repository of LGBTQ materials in the world. The One Archives Foundation is the independent community partner supporting One Archives. And In Plain Sight, or IPS, is a coalition of 80 artists dedicated to the abolition of immigrant detention. In Plain Sight orchestrated the hashtag XMAP skytyping that was seen nationwide over the 4th of July weekend, which made visible detention facilities, immigration courts, borders, and other physical sites of American incarceration culture. Tonight's panel explores the various practices and strategies used by Japanese American artists, scholars, and community organizers to represent and remember the histories of Japanese American incarceration by the US government during World War II. Each of our panelists will speak to their practice in relation to wartime incarceration histories, archiving, storytelling, and memory. This program draws connections between past and present calls to abolish all forms of immigrant detention. I'll now introduce a little bit about each of our speakers, and Lexi will also be dropping their full bios in the chat. Our first panelist is Nancy Ukai. Nancy is a Sansei, a Topaz descendant, and the project director of 50 Objects, a history project that examines the ramifications of Executive Order 9066. Next, we have Karen Ishizuka, the chief curator at the Japanese American National Museum. She is also an award-winning filmmaker and the author of Serve the People, Making Asian America in the 60s. Next, we have Tina Takemoto, who is an artist and visual studies scholar whose work explores queer sexuality of Japanese Americans incarcerated during World War II. Our last panelist is Traci kato-kiriyama, who is a writer, theater artist, community organizer, and actor. They are the presenter of the Tuesday Night Cafe series, which is the longest running Asian American produced mic series in the country. Last but not least, we have Umi, who is the moderator for our panel tonight. Umi is the director of content strategy at the One Archives Foundation. And behind the scenes running the chat and organizing the event, we have Lexi Bard Johnson, who is the curator at One Archives at USC. So without further ado, please welcome Nancy, who will be presenting first. And give us just a second so that we can get the presentations up. But thank you all for being here.
I'll share my screen here.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Nancy Ukai, and I'm project director of the 50 Objects Project. And this is a website that explores the material culture of the World War II Japanese American concentration camps. Recently, we published a story about an object that was created 77 years ago, but doesn't exist anymore. It was a monument, and it was built against official orders, so it was built by resistors, to memorialize the death of an innocent man who was shot to death at the Topaz, Utah camp by a military guard. They built this monument, and what you see here is a photo of what we do know from archival documents about the monument. The monument was ordered destroyed by the government, and so there's no physical thing left anymore, but we do know from the archival documents that it was made from cement, sand, and rocks. And so this is our imagining of what was left after it was ordered demolished. So this is a photograph of a file of the man who was killed, and it's from the National Archives. His name was James Hatsuaki Wakasa. And on April 11th, 1943, Wakasa was walking his dog inside the fence when he was killed by Gerald Philpott, a 19-year-old Guard Tower sentry from North Carolina. He shot Wakasa with one bullet to the heart, which severed his spinal cord from a distance of more than 300 yards. That's a distance of 3 football fields. It's far. Wakasa, 63, was born in 1880. He was a graduate of Keio University in Tokyo, and he was a chef who lived in this country for 40 years. The soldier was acquitted. He was quietly transferred out. But a few Issei men who were outraged by the murder of Wakasa, in violation of orders not to, built a monument where he died. They stole a bag and a half of cement, and they created this monument. But soon after, the officials, government officials, forced them to demolish it and therefore erase the memory of what they wanted future generations to remember. And wartime documents from the archives, and this is something we like to do at 50 Objects, is really explore how the artifact expresses the human lives, the context of what happened, and use archival materials to support what we're, to learn more about the object. Wartime documents in the National Archives testify to the existence of the monument and the concern that the government had. So here's a letter from the Assistant Secretary of War, John McCloy, to Dylan Meyer, head of the WRA, the War Relocation Authority. Wakasa's death arose as a result of a justifiable military action, and it seems most inappropriate that a monument be erected to him. Wakasa was shot and he died parallel to the fence, 5 feet inside it, with his head facing north and his feet facing south. The head of the Topaz camp wrote back immediately saying, the monument has been torn down and the rocks which were used in this construction have been completely removed from sight. It was very humiliating for the people who built it and for the whole camp, which was extremely traumatized by this murder. So what happened was, after we published this story, soon after we received a letter from an 86-year-old man who was 9 years old at Topaz when Wakasa was shot. And he said he'd like to open in the to walk in the open desert area to collect rocks and things. And he would run into an elderly man who might say, it's getting late, go back home. And the man wrote a handwritten letter and said, wrote to us, one evening, a friend and I happened to cross paths with him as we were heading back to the barracks. Suddenly, we heard a series of pop, pop, like firecrackers behind us. And we just ran as fast as we could, never looking back. The next morning, there was much commotion that a one Mr. Wakasa was shot to death by a guard. My mother took me to the funeral service, and seeing Mr. Wakasa lying in the casket has haunted me for years. Bad memories are hard to erase. So I spoke with him on the phone, and he said that after Pearl Harbor, his family had been chased from their home in New Mexico by vigilantes. His father was an immigrant from Japan. He spoke of holding his dead dog in his arms, the warm blood on his hands. The family spent 1 year at the old Raton Ranch camp in New Mexico before being transferred to Utah, where he may have been the last person to see Wakasa alive, other than the sentry. And so I was really interested in thinking that the One Archives was asking us to think about how you mobilize memory. And I think this shows that archival work can mobilize memory, and that this Wakasa story motivated this 86-year-old man in Ohio to write us. Archives hold historical information, of course, and their excavation can move people to reveal buried memories. So I just want to ask, what does this story about this man have to do with this photo of Japanese American activists in Fort Sill, Oklahoma? So the five people standing in the front row who are holding posters were all children in the World War II camps, like the man who wrote us a letter. And in June 2019, I was among them, and so is Karen Ishizuka, who is holding up a rope of cranes in the back. We flew to Oklahoma from California, Seattle, Washington, and New Mexico to protest US government plans to incarcerate 1,600 Central American children at this base, Fort Sill in Oklahoma. Fort Sill actually has a century-long history of incarcerating children, people of color, Native Americans in the late 1800s, Japanese immigrant men and Buddhist priests during World War II, 700 of them. And in 2019, the government planned to detain children from Central America. So the protesters are members of Tsuru for Solidarity, which is a national movement of activists who take hand-folded paper cranes, or tsuru, to protest immigrant detention and to show Japanese American solidarity against the Muslim ban, family separation, and in support of the movement for Black lives. After a second protest there at Fort Sill, there was another one the following month, the government suspended its plans to confine children at the base. And I really think that when Japanese Americans, when we Japanese Americans know our own history of incarceration, family separation, deportation, murder, and exclusion, we can make the connection much better between our experience, our families, our communities of racial oppression, and understand why the fight for the rights of asylum seekers today, immigrants today, migrant children today, is a Japanese American fight too. And this photograph on the left is of Masao Shibayama, who's a three-year-old boy in the Seattle area in 1942. And the one on the right is of a small boy from in South Texas at the border, who was his father and he were caught. And it's just so striking, the visual similarities of the gun, the vehicle, the small child, and shows that history is indeed repeating itself. So never again is now, and stop repeating history, are calls to raise awareness that Tsuru for Solidarity and other Japanese Americans and Asian Americans and people use. Our first action was in South Texas, where the Crystal City concentration camp was located. So in March 2019, about 60 pilgrims visited the remains of the old Crystal City camp and then drove an hour east on the same highway to hold a protest against history repeating itself, the detention of women and babies at the Dilley Immigration Detention Center. We took 25,000 paper cranes to hang on the barbed wire fence. And this is something that we put a call out on social media, and within 1 week, we got 10,000 folded cranes from every Maine, Florida, Ohio, all over the country. And then by the second week, we had 25,000 to take. So on this pilgrimage to South Texas, on this pilgrimage and protests were Peruvian Japanese, as well as who were babies and toddlers when they were basically kidnapped and taken by ship and train to Crystal City, Texas from Latin America to be used in a US prisoner exchange program. Also on the pilgrimage were four American citizens who were incarcerated under the guard towers at Crystal City. And they came and to the pilgrimage wanting to visit for the first time the concentration camp where they spent part of their childhood. And then an hour later, we went to the protest. And for many of them, actually, this was the first time in their life, they said, to take part in a protest. But the link between what they had experienced and what's happening now was too strong to ignore. So 2 weeks ago, this just I'll wind up on this, at the San Francisco International Arts Festival, Tsuru for Solidarity members took 545 hand-folded paper cranes in honor of and to remember the 545 children that the US government has recently admitted separating from their parents without any way to know how to reunite them. And the artist, Naomi Shintani, you'll see some sort of little beds at the bottom of the screen. She had placed several of them in this beautiful area above Fort Mason. And on these mattresses, she has painted sleeping children who she calls innocent dreamers. And her ritual, which she called Dream Refuge for Children Imprisoned, she wrote, "This is our American story. Their trauma is intergenerational. Only in dreams can they meet and find refuge." Thank you.
Hi. Thank you so much, One Archive, IPS, all my sisters on the panel. This has been quite a week, and it's wonderful to spend this time with you. I thought the combination of the arts and archives and activism was really important. You know, now these days, artists are really important in our attempt to make this world a better place. And I think that your inclusion of archives was really, you know, very, very resonant. This is one that I did. Lexi, can you actually show the first one for the other one first, please? So this is a billboard that I did for Four Freedoms. Four Freedoms is an artist-led activist organizations that is just so profound and so everywhere right now. I think one of the latest activisms that you might have been aware of was the Wide Awakes, you know, in New York a couple of weeks ago. But I have been involved with Four Freedoms in a couple of things that they've done. And I was invited to be one of the artists that to create a billboard. It was called their 50 state initiative, and they put billboards in every state of the country. And what I did here was use a historical photograph from the Japanese American National Museum. This is from a line going to a mess hall at Tule Lake. It's familiar to anyone who has been in camp. But I superimposed the hashtag "You Are Here." And, you know, I used "You Are Here" just to evoke a feeling of asserting the past into the present, or the present into the past, to remind us of the United States' continuing legacy of mass incarceration, and that I am you, they are us, and you too could be, are, will be here. It's something that I hoped that would just evoke some thought. And Lexi, if you could go to the next one. This is a picture of the photograph in situ. It was at in Des Moines, Iowa. So I got a big kick out of the fact that it was near the Air National Guard General Aviation turnoff. But this is an example of putting art and the archives into the public domain. And, you know, who knows, you know, who has seen it, who has thought about it. But we did that in 2018 of one for every state, and Four Freedoms has done that again now. So I believe that they are up now in every state. And then I just wanted to draw attention to my background. And I was told that it's probably dyslexic. You can read it backwards, but it says no more camps. And this was part of an activation that Tina and I were fortunate to be part of in plain sight. So this was my phrase, no more camps, that I did in connection with Tsuru for Solidarity. So with members of Tsuru for Solidarity, we came up with the phrase, no more camps, in order to make a nod once again to the fact that there have been camps and there should be no more camps. And this was, my sign was over a Santa Anita racetrack here in the Los Angeles area. And Santa Anita was the largest so-called assembly center during World War II. It had something like 18,000 people. And it was astonishing to know that just like today, the racetrack was transferred into a concentration camp in less than 7 days. They first put people in the horse stalls while they built 500 barracks throughout the parking lot area. So it's hidden in plain sight, basically. The Santa Anita is still a working racetrack, and its history belies the fact that it has been used as a concentration camp, you know, in the past. So that was my short presentation.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I'll be talking about looking for Jiro. This project is inspired by Jiro Anuma, a gay man who moved to the US from Japan in the 1920s. His archival collection at the GLBT Historical Society consists of a few photo albums filled with pictures of Anuma and his friends and lovers around San Francisco, and he's shown in the middle of this photo. His collection also demonstrates that he was an avid collector of homoerotic male physical culture and kitsch. I am especially fond of this matador postcard that has a bronze necktie penis, bronze penis necktie clip that can be removed from the matador, worn in the evening, and then replaced back to its appropriate owner at the end of the evening. And Onuma's collection also contains rare photos taken while he was imprisoned at Topaz incarceration camp. This one shows Onuma and his workmates in the mess hall of Block 3 at Topaz. My work seeks to imagine how Anuma survived the isolation, boredom, humiliation, and heteronormativity of incarceration as a dandy gay bachelor from San Francisco. So I started by looking at the art of gamon, which refers to art making practices in camp using found objects such as scraps of wood that were transformed into small birds and made into pins. For my project, Gentleman's Gamon, I created what I think of as a shadow archive of items that I thought Jiro Anuma might have liked, including a carved bird tie clip and set of bird cufflinks, a wallet and cigarette holder made of tar paper, and a Hanafuda flower card set. In these sets, they usually have a special animal on some of the cards, and I replace them with muscle men. Looking for Jiro was also a drag king performance and mashup music video that was set in camp, performed by me, and it was set to a Madonna ABBA musical soundtrack. Jiro's character in this performance is caught in a state of longing and desire where time goes by so slowly when you're waiting for a lover who will never arrive in prison. During the performance, his character mirrors the actions of hardworking Japanese American inmates shown in US war propaganda footage. But in this queer fantasy, Jiro also refuses to participate in this labor. As Madonna declares, he's fed up and tired of waiting on you. Through his acts of homoerotic bread making, Jiro fulfills his desire for bodybuilders as he fists his way towards being and becoming his own muscular fantasy. And I'm just going to show you a minute and a half.
Oh my gosh, that was so awesome. I was hooping and hollering over here. I am so grateful to be a part of this group and this panel. It's like the panel of my dreams. I've never been able to share space with this particular group and to talk about the combination, like Karen was saying. It was so keen to talk about art and movement building, activism, and archives. Like, I love that so much. So I wanted to just start with a story. I hadn't thought to share this, but I, you know, in Nancy's presentation, you showed a picture of little Masaru Shibayama at age 3 next to a soldier with a rifle. And it reminded me of a story that my mom has told me that my grandfather told to her through somebody else long after he died. And the story was that, and she didn't know this until she was much older, but my Uncle Tommy had told her that my grandpa was very, very proud of this one particular moment right at the beginning of the war in terms of the involvement of the US and the bombing of Pearl Harbor. My grandfather had a nursery, Kato nursery, in Inglewood, right next to LAX. And so the army came and set up on their nursery. full on with the guns, the rifles, everything. And my grandfather asked my Uncle Roy and my mom, who were 4.5 and 2.5. My mom was 2.5 years old. And he said, do you want to go to grandma's? Because the army's here. And my uncle was scared. He was very scared. And he was like, we have to go. I want to go. I don't want to be here. I want to go to grandma's. And my mom at 2.5, like, stomped her feet. And she's like, no, this is our home. And she just kept screaming, this is our home.
Wow.
And my grandpa wrote much later and shared with our family through my uncle how proud he was of my mom. And I wanted to share that story because I think that I've been sort of chasing that story. I've been sort of chasing where that pain comes from and where that fire comes from. My mom was always someone who was a role model for me to speak out and to be involved and engaged, and it affected me and it moved me to places where I met with my big sisters like Karen, you know, to learn further about the extension of that fire and its solidarity and its place with other communities of struggle and in our history. And so that's really a lot about what my work is. You know, my work is very much about in community building work and movement oriented work. And even in my facilitation work of the past 20 or so years, I've been, especially in the past decade, very proactively co-creating space with folks that's very deliberately intergenerational. And that has in turn very much so affected my process as an artist and even the content of my writing. So yeah, I just really appreciate everybody's presentation because it really made me think about all of these things as, you know, what we call, what has been called a lot of times memory work. It's also connector work. I feel like we're in the business, our line of business is about connecting past to present to future. And and so for me, it's really grounded in people and community as my why. So I'm just gonna show 3 photos in relation to this idea of this combination of art and movement orientation, movement building, community building, and archival utilization. So I'll show the first photo. Thank you, Lexi, for supporting that. So as Karen was talking about with the IPS project, Devin Suno was another one of the 80 artists that were invited to be one of the artists for In Plain Sight over the July 4th weekend. And Devin was introduced to me by a mutual friend, Zen Sekizawa, and we got into a conversation about sort of, yeah, his project. He wanted me to collaborate with him. And he decided that he wanted to do a phone number as his sky typing message. And, but he wasn't quite sure, you know, what to populate that with. And so through many conversations, we landed on some recorded material that I had from the year before from a residency. So we populated into the phone number, which you can still call. You can still call this number. We still have this number. We have a long message of English translations of letters from inside detention centers, as well as letters of solidarity from people on the outside. It's a pretty long recording, but you can hear many different voices. And over the July 4th weekend, this number was skytyped above the Laredo, Texas Customs and Border Patrol. And we received over 4,000 calls that weekend alone, and we've continued to receive calls. If you stay on through the whole recording, you can leave a message at the end. And remarkably, even after a 10-minute message of some, you know, pretty intense recordings, many people actually stayed on and left even more powerful responses. So we're continuing that project. We're going to be getting together in a couple months to sort of think about the different ways we want to keep populating and distributing this number. And then we can go to the second photo. The recordings came from this project. So I was part of the Plus Lab residency in Little Tokyo. And I was Karen Ishizuka's intern and staff back in the day. Our offices were in that building, which we called the old building, the Nishi building. Facing this building is the more modern, the contemporary glass-walled museum where all the offices are now housed. And so I really wanted to have a conversation between the past and the present in relation to family separation as we were looking at issues of displacement as a theme for the residency. And so we, a lot of my work is sort of in devised theater and collaborative ensemble work. So we had several actors reading letters in multiple languages from different time periods. It was a conversation really between the past and present. So on the old Nishi building, as you see, we had large scale projections of letters from World War II incarceration that I combed through, just tons and tons of letters in the collections department at the museum. And on the other side of it, I should have probably had that photo. We'll send these out. But on the other side of it, we had projections, large scale projections of letters from present day in terms of detention centers, as well as letters of solidarity. So we incorporated movement that was also related to issues of noise and solidarity, collective noise and breaking of silence, as well as sort of, just this idea of mirroring and through the mirror, how we see each other. So we devised some choreography based upon that. And then with Umi, Sue, and other folks involved in the project, we also had the pleasure of having music that was also derived, a typewriter and different instruments were, an accordion were used to kind of further interpret what was happening in this conversation. So in general, I feel like my work is very much about the personal as political. And when it comes to this idea of connection work or memory work, I focus a lot on this idea of, past, present, future conversation. And then for the last photograph, another piece that I'm continuing to work on is a project called Tales of Clamor. And it's a play that's based in theater, and it incorporates circus aerial arts because my stage partner, Kennedy Cabasaris, is an aerial artist. And so we do a lot of narrative interpretation based in theater and aerial arts. And this particular piece, we really do focus a lot on the present moment of detention that, regardless of administration, continues and will continue. And we anchored this moment in a sort of debate around silence and noise, the virtues of quiet and silence and the virtues of collective noise. And we really look particularly at the moment of the 1981 Commission on Wartime Relocation and Internment of Civilians. There was a hearing in 1981 where the community, many members of the community in 10 different cities across the country, broke their silence for the first time around their incarceration experience nearly four decades after being put away. So this piece is really grounded in that moment through sort of a present day lens. So that's a bit of my focus, and this is something that's also an ongoing project. Thank you.
Wow. I'm so moved by so many of the projects, and personally, I've been a fan of all of your works. So this is, like you said, Trey, kind of a dream panel for me too. I'm really curious, how everybody here seems to really feel comfortable in that space, like that intersection between activism, archives, and art, and kind of move fluidly between these practices. I think, got interested in sort of thinking about activating this idea of activating the present by injecting something of the past into the present. Also, you know, by making art that's in dialogue with the past, and just love that. So my questions are more or less meant to be prompts for y'all. Like, you know, think of it as like a departure point, and you know, do you want you to kind of take it in a direction that's most fruitful for you? So the first question I have is about memories. Many of you have talked about memories of your own, memories of others, and how memories could be shared. And that seems to be kind of a thread, you know, that you have found a way, a creative way to connect memories with something larger, like something intersubjective, the collective consciousness. And so I'm just curious, you know, wanting to hear a bit more about how you treat memories of your own in your own work. And what about how, you know, just this question about how you treat other people's memories, and what questions do you ask when you make decisions about memories, especially those that are not of your own? And feel free to kind of, you know, wrestle with this in ways that are productive for you. So I don't want to cold call, but I feel like Nancy is ready to share. Any thoughts on this, Nancy? Oh, you're muted.
It's a great question. And, you know, we do our work through objects, and people say, oh, objects are, you know, it's the material evidence that something happened. And objects are mute witnesses to history, and these kinds of cliches, right? But in fact, you have to dig into them. Otherwise, you end up projecting your own ideas onto what you think it is. So if somebody sees a bird pin, they may think, oh, that's so beautiful. That is, which, you know, it might be. Or that person was so skilled, and despite all of the hardship, they created something beautiful. And I'm not saying that it wasn't beautiful, but I'm also resisting the kind of aestheticization, the prettifying of basically prison art. And so that's why when we're doing our 50 objects, we're not just looking at crafts. So that's just one thing. And the more that you talk to people and the more that you do archival work, first of all, I'm finding that the fractures that occurred because of the war, you find that people know each other in maybe the generation above you or above that, because you find their names on lists from the archives. And so, for example, in the Wakasa killing murder, there was a group of Issei who came together, two from every barrack at Topaz. And there's a list, there were 64 of them. And when I look at the list, I know the granddaughters and the children of some of those Issei people. And they knew each other, they were probably in meetings together, but those stories didn't get told. We don't know them ourselves. And so this is a case where the archives tell you something. So for me, it's this kind of memory needs, I'm happy to find the information in the archives. And to me, that's why I could just really live there. And I just like to say one more thing, which is not related to the archives, but art. And Judy Shintani painted those sleeping children on the mattresses. Mattresses have a lot of meaning for Japanese Americans because, you know, people were given body bags to stuff straw in when they got to some of those early concentration camps. Sleeping is also important. We know these children in cages are sleeping on the floor on these mylar blankets. But when I saw Judy's painted child on a mattress the other day, I thought of the 86-year-old man who talked about the warm blood of the dog on his hands and, you know, talking to Wakasa or seeing Wakasa right before he died, because he said to me, for the longest time, I couldn't go to sleep at night, and my mother would sit with me in the barrack and calm me because I couldn't go to sleep. And when I saw Judy's painting of children trying to sleep, innocent dreamers, it just, for me, connected once again the violence of incarceration.
Thanks so much, Nancy. Would anybody else like to jump in and talk about memories?
Yeah, I mean, I love this question. I think a lot about, I do think a lot about responsibility and that being a very particular privilege to hold people's voices in our hands, like in the form of these letters and objects, pieces of survival art. you know, when we were launching Tales of Clamor, we knew that it would bring up a lot for people, whether or not they knew about the subject matter, in that we were, you know, drawing some very direct connections between communities, various communities, as well as various time periods. And we were essentially, you know, we were very clear, we weren't really doing a redress play. We were doing a play about silence and the breaking of silence, right? A sort of a dynamic between noise, between clamor and between silence. So we made sure that in the production, we ran for 5 weeks. So at every single show, we had community sharebacks, like without fail. And I wish now that we had recorded those, because that to me sometimes was like the most powerful point of the evening for me, to really have a space for people to, after being filled up, to share and connect with other folks and to listen to other people. Like, that's so important. And then we would also have each weekend an extended symposium between shows. And one in particular where we invited folks from different communities to talk about, again, different aspects of breaking silence and sort of like thinking about issues of the past that they are still trying to find justice for, that they are still traumatized by. You know, we had somebody who spoke about the comfort woman issue. You know, we had someone, a good friend, who was speaking about sort of her awakening as a musician into the women's movement, and sort of dealing with her own path as a survivor in that vein. And so we had circles, small group circles that we facilitated so that people could, again, work through and like express and connect with others about their own sort of historic trauma. So I do think that in putting out any kind of like performance per se, there needs to be some very thoughtful space for people to connect around the material that they're filling up on. Because yeah, I think we are not just talking about what's right in front of us, but of course we're digging in, we're diving in, we're nudging, we're connecting with other people's paths of pain. And so I do take that very seriously.
Thanks so much for that. And I think, you know, what's striking to me is that memories becomes a dialogue. It seems like, you know, it is something that could be re-energized and re-entered into kind of the consciousness of our day. And, you know, I just love how so much of your work, all of your work, you're able to kind of move between like different historical periods, you know, present and past. And I think, you know, in doing this work of like retelling histories, especially about trauma and wars, there's this risk of like re-traumatizing. You know, I wrestle with that a lot, you know, in the work that I do, and also in the contents production work that I do here at the foundation. So I'm curious, like, I'm sure you've given so much thought to this. I'm curious if you have any wisdom to share about that, like, you know, about like just how you approach, you know, retelling stories that are difficult to the different audiences. And Tina, you know, I'm sort of especially interested to hear from you, because I feel like you found a way to wrestle with the past, even when there's no story that really, no objects that you could have found to really represent a particular history that you know existed. So like, could you tell us a little bit about what that was like for you?
Sure, yeah, thanks. I mean, with Jiro Onuma, in his archive, there are photos, but there aren't any love letters or any kinds of his own writing. So I think we are left with these objects or material traces to wonder about what his life might have been like. I mean, the photos from the 1930s, his photo albums are filled with images of Japanese American men, dandyish gentlemen hanging out together in Golden Gate Park, and it looks like such a spectacular moment in a way. At the same time, you know, the reality was that he worked in a laundry in what is now the Tenderloin, in a situation that was kind of like a bachelor's quarters, so where the men worked downstairs and then stayed in rooms upstairs, probably in bunk beds with, you know, multiple folks in a room. So I think there's a way in which the images that he left us tell us a lot about what he aspired for in his life. So, you know, there's one or two professional photos that he probably stayed up to be able to take with his friends. But the rest are really, you know, outdoors and standing in front of cars that they probably didn't own. So when I thought about how to make work inspired by his legacy, I wanted to focus on the emotional qualities of what it might have been like for him going from this, you know, somewhat vibrant life in San Francisco in the 30s, and then finding himself incarcerated at the age of 38 and in barracks that were organized by family units. So it wasn't even, you know, same gender barracks in the way we think of other kinds of prisons, or the possibility of queer fantasy in prisons. So I wanted to open up a space that was both humorous, but also hopefully somewhat tender, where he could be working in the mess hall, but also imagining this, you know, super hot queer fantasy.
I love that. I love the way you play with the emotions, the possible emotional landscape with a historical person and their stories. So this is, you know, I feel like, Karen, your work, you know, is so public, right? Like, you know, the fact that you put historical photos on billboards, and you mentioned that there's an image in every state, you know, and I think, you know, this question of like telling stories to such different audiences, you know, like we don't really know who's driving by the interstate when they see this billboard that has a historical like photo that tells a story of wartime incarceration. Like what's some of your wisdom? Like what do you hope to share? What kind of like, you know, how do you tell a story that's so difficult that not many people would, I don't know, like, you know, how do you key into the message that you want to share?
Thank you. You know, I hope Lexi or someone can put up a link to Tina's article on looking for Jiro Onuma. It's so incredibly important. And one of the hidden histories, I think, you know, I've been doing this kind of work for a long time, and I'm always amazed at how much more there is to find out. Tina's work with Jiro, it was in, and she also just really beautifully told that story as well. And, you know, I wanted also, you know, in terms of something that Tracy brought up, you know, Tales of Clamor, she did on a stage and all of the audience was also on the stage. So it gave a sort of intimacy of just even spatial intimacy that we were there. And the dialogues that happened after the performances. And I think that, you know, it's that kind of post-performance kind of actions, you know, that are maybe even more important than the performance itself, you know, and the performance itself, you know, catalyzed it. But, you know, I think in similar to what Traci did, and at Tsuru for Solidarity, and Nancy Ukai is one of the three original founders. Another of her co-founder is Dr. Satsuki Ina, who's a psychotherapist. And she put together what we are calling healing circles. So, you know, it's really after an action and after a protest, you know, when we were in Fort Sill, for example, the experience was so profound. You know, we were up so long, but we could not go back, you know, to our rooms in this hotel. And the sharing of that experiences afterwards was so amazing. And I think, you know, Satsuki has really put a lot of her own experience as a psychotherapist in back of it. And it's and actually those of us who have become healing circles facilitators have gone through, you know, a couple of hours even of training with her. But now we are doing healing circles and, you know, virtually. So for example, you know, Tsuru for Solidarity, we were working up to a large action in Washington, D.C. that we built, and I think it would have been the largest concentration of Japanese Americans since the war. There were so many people who registered. So many people worked on it in many, many states. And of course, because of the pandemic, we decided we couldn't do it. But instead, we had a weekend pilgrimage with just amazing talks, panels, performances, music. But we also held healing circles. And it was so moving because, you know, it is a work of healing. And I think, you know, for myself as well, you know, I think during this really difficult time with Trumpism and the pandemic and the migrant situation and so much, there is just a lot of healing that needs to be done. And I think Tsuru is one activist organization that has built that in to its program, its mission. And at this point, we are continuing to do healing circles, for example, after community conversations that Tsuru holds, that's open to so many. And we have people, not only Japanese Americans or Asian Americans, a lot of BIPOC people. And, you know, that's one thing that we decided from the beginning was that all the facilitators would be BIPOC. That's, you know, one discrimination we made, because I think that we very seldom are able to hold our own safe spaces. And we felt that that was really important. But it was, other than that, it was, you know, very, very open. And it's not therapy, it's not group therapy, but it's a way to share. And to share the memories. And I think it's by sharing those memories and reaching across ethnicities, races, religions, to share those things that make us who we are and who make me, you, and you, myself, and us, them. That's really healing.
Thanks so much for sharing. I think, you know, so much going on now with all the polarizations that are happening, you know, very strong emotions coming through media in ways that are sometimes very, very, very unanticipated and insidious. I'm just curious, like, what is going on? Like, how are you engaging with the things that are happening in our current moment? How are you processing what's happening? Like, you know, how are you taking care of yourself or your community? And feel free to kind of answer this question in, you know, in a personal way, or, you know, if it sort of connects to your practice as well, we'd love to hear that. Anybody wants to volunteer? This is a very
I think things like this.
That's great. Yeah.
Processing, you know, it really is. Especially now where we can't physically be together, we can be together in this space. And I think that for me, you know, in I was not in camp, you know, I'm one of the descendants. I think I inherited camp even though I wasn't there. And, you know, it was a lot of it was because of child rearing practices. I think we were so taught to be 200% American. And I think a lot of BIPOC people are taught this. And I think my parents especially had this feeling that, you know, if we were really good, if I got all A's, if I was really good, somehow they would understand that it was wrong to have put them into camp. And, you know, this is something that, you know, they were silenced, both in terms of words and emotions. So, you know, it is this sort of self-care, and really one way that I see us healing is to, you know, as Tutu always says, you know, be the allies that we didn't have. You know, and really that in itself has been very healing to me, just to be part, to work with Tracy and Tina and Nancy and so many other people, and to work on something bigger than just ourselves. And it's really, that's where I think a lot of the healing takes place.
I would just definitely want to build off of that point to see that our work is necessary so that we can be like the strongest allies as possible, to center other folks and not, I don't like to, it's interesting because we're talking about Japanese American incarceration and our work in relation to it. But I do think that what I am most drawn to are like the connections to other communities or other, you know, yeah, definitely other communities and other struggles as we're working through all of this and to celebrate these moments. Like I feel like Tina, I was really so, I think I was dancing in my chair because I feel like that's gotta be part of the work too, is I think we survive because we find moments of connection through levity and laughter and humor as well, and celebration and that kind of strength and fantasy and dreams, you know? So I think like, that's really important too, to just have these spaces to be able to talk about those things as well. And I think for me, like it's kind of simple. Like for me, maintaining sanity really centers around like staying close to my process, my practice as an artist. You know, having sometimes just the paper and the pen to run to. And when that doesn't work, you know, well, maybe not just because that doesn't work, but alongside that process, like staying close with the community as well. Like I can't survive without either. If that makes any sense.
If I can just add to what Tracy and Karen said about basically the embodiment too, of it's not just mental that you're going to an archive and reading something and interpreting it, but in the case of Tsuru, part of the genius of Mike Ishii calling out for people to fold cranes is that it's this embodied thing where you can sit around in a virtual circle like this and be folding and then have something which you can then share. And 2 months ago, the Bay Area group of Tsuru put out a call for folding for Jacob Blake, who of course had been shot in the back 7 times by the police in Kenosha. And in 2 days, many dozens of people signed up and folded 2,000 cranes. And they said, we don't want it to just be something pretty, so please write a message. And the outpouring of love and emotion and letters on written on the wings was just so overwhelming. And I think we should publish them or post them so people will feel uplifted. And then somebody from the Wisconsin JCL said, we'll take them there because we've got people who will, you know, get us into the hospital. So there's now boxes sitting in Wisconsin, but I think that feeling of wanting to do something, like Karen, you said, like heal, share, fold, has stirred people in a way that just say writing a protest sign might not do, but somehow the crane has this power that links people. And it also has the effect of drawing in people who may not be very political, but say, oh, I can fold cranes. It's sort of like activism 101, fold a crane.
I have to say that, you know, when you all started the Tsuru, I just thought that was the silliest thing, you know, because I was really advocating from a museum standpoint, we need to get beyond origami and piñatas, you know, in order to really talk about what cultural exchange is. However, you know, I have really found that that this tsuru making is simple, and because it's simple, like Nancy said, everybody can do it. So Nancy and I were, I think that's when we first met, is on the airplane to Lawton, Oklahoma. And Nancy was folding cranes. And I tell you, before we landed, she had 3 or 4 or 5 people, you know, people who we didn't know, say, oh, what are you doing? And why is it, you know, and she said, oh, well, we're doing this and because of that, and we're going to protest, and the tsuru means this. And so it was an engaging process that was really humbling to me, especially. So it really worked, Nancy.
Love that. Yeah, I actually fold to slow down, which, you know, is a contemplative practice for me. So, but I really do appreciate kind of the community building aspect of this. So, I know that we have some time and I haven't seen any questions coming in from the audience. So I've got one more question to ask all the panelists, but if you have any questions, feel free to type into the chat box, audience members. I think we also have enabled the Q&A box as well. So if you want to ask your questions there, please do so. So my next question, and hopefully final question, other people could get to ask their question. So it's actually about storytelling. Stories seem to be very central to all of what you do. And what do you think of the role of artists as a storyteller? Like, you know, particularly in relation to future generations. And do you think that artists should have a responsibility in telling stories of their time and of those who came before them to future people, future communities? Tina, would you like to give it a shot?
Sure. I think because my medium is experimental film or performance, I think it's interesting to think about that as a mode of storytelling in relation to something like documentary, because we usually think of documentary or oral history or as something that's more tangible or lived or real. I think what attracts me to making experimental work is that we can also think about how history is told and what the limitations of it are. So for instance, when, for all of us who have seen a lot of documentaries about Japanese American wartime incarceration, you start to notice that it's the same war propaganda footage that's utilized in all of these documentaries. And it's partly because this is some of the few moving images that we have available, and it's imagery that's in the public domain. So I became really interested in how we as artists can use that imagery, but also make the imagery strange or queer the imagery. Because of course the intended purpose of that imagery was to show hardworking Japanese Americans who were incarcerated, but could be eligible to work in your factory on the East Coast or to join the workforce. I think part of my strategy in storytelling is also to ask the question, why is it that we continue to tell stories in particular ways? And also, what are the available materials? What do we have available to us? And what are the absences that are embedded in those materials? So even just, editing, slowing things down, repeating it, juxtaposing it, making it look like, Jiro Onuma might want to do inappropriate things to a 442nd military recruit, things like that are possible in experimental media. I'm also challenging the ways we continue to tell the story of wartime incarceration, we meaning Japanese Americans, that we often still focus on moments of heroism, moments of patriotism, of loyalty, of endurance. I would like to expand that to also be, moments of queer desire, of not belonging, folks who are single, feminists, activists, no-no boys, those stories are also really important to me.
I'd like to actually read something that speaks to your question, Umi. And it comes from Bruce Iwasaki, who wrote this in Counterpoint, which was the second anthology of Asian American Studies in 1976, Counterpoint Perspectives on Asian America. And he wrote an introduction to the literature portion, but he wrote, third world writing provides a critique of America from people who are uniquely prepared to provide one, discouraged from doing so, and able to illuminate how these two conditions are related. Thus, I impose upon the writer an active duty to know his or her time. So I think, that is a responsibility of the artists, and what the combination of art and activism and now with the archives can really do.
I like the idea of finding different ways of storytelling. I think the sky writing was brilliant. I like what Tina was saying about, queering Jiro's story. I think it's interesting to think of cultural modes of storytelling, because you so often meet people who say, oh, my story, it's not that important, or, you know, what you have to get, it's a process to get to know people, to talk to them about bringing out their family story or the story of an object. And so I wish Japanese Americans, and when we go out and think, how can we, you know, do justice to our family stories, our ancestors. And so creative ways of skywriting, and it's great. And I hope that, you know, we can be the nail that sticks up.
I think for me with storytelling, you know, in honor of Scorpio season, I'll just say that we Scorpios don't really do well with small talk. In my experience, maybe I should only speak for myself, but nevertheless, I don't like it. And for me, what I love about offering 3 minutes or 90 minutes of art is the conversation after. And when people say to me, you know what that made me think about? Or you know what that made me feel? And then we're there. We're not at the surface level of conversation. We just go right there to like what's in our gut and our feeling and our spirit. And I love that. And I think when it comes to responsibility, I feel like artists are in the line of business of questioning and visioning forward. So it's our responsibility to pay attention. And if we're paying attention to both our honest experience and diving into that, but also as it relates to what's around us, what it's been said, right? The material is all around us. The material is all around the storyteller. The material is available to the writer, to the artist. And so I think if we're paying attention, even just like the least bit, there's so much to respond to, you know? And at a certain point, it's not because of our history, right? That we respond in solidarity. It's because it's the right effing thing to do. You know, it's the human thing to do. And I love a good story from anybody. I'm curious, you know?
I'll definitely stop the small talk next time I show up at one of the events, Trey. Note to self. So this next question actually came from one of our audience members. Alex has this great question. Just noticing that y'all have been doing this work for some time now and wants to know if you have noticed any willingness to share personal and often traumatic stories and how that willingness has changed over time. Has generational gap played a role? And how have you found ways to bridge that gap?
Okay, I'll take a step. I think it has changed over time. And I think that, you know, just as we stand on the shoulders of those who came before us, the stories change as well. You know, right after the war, no one talked. There were no stories. It was a travesty of democracy that the government, you know, didn't want to publicize. Very few people knew about it then, and I think even now. And then after the war, in this sort of post-war American exceptionalism, you know, there was a deeper silence. And I think it was until after the Cold War, and in the 60s, you know, with the civil rights, with the Asian American movement, with those of us, you know, who were in our early 20s, in the late 60s, asking the questions, you know, what is this camp that we hear about it, but no one talks about it? it's in code. You know, we heard about before the war and after the war. We heard stories about before the war. I used to take piano lessons. You know, I had ballet lessons. And then after the war, I had to go to work with my father every Saturday. But, you know, nothing, we didn't know of any of the stories that severed those two universes into such distinct pieces. So I think that, you know, I think we Sansei, you know, were actually criticized in the late 60s for bringing these things up. Why can't you let bygones be bygones? Don't cry over spilt milk. And I think that, you know, eventually, you know, we were able to sort of help Nisei and Issei unlock the Pandora's box that they had kept so tightly shut. Of course, it doesn't break down totally on generational lines. There were some fierce Issei and some fierce Nisei who talked about it from the very, very beginning. But they were a minority, and I think they got silenced not only by the outer society, but by our community as well. So I do see the stories change. And, you know, I think before there used to be a rallying cry of never forget, remember what happened so that it doesn't happen again. But now I actually see the issue is not so much trying to remember, but not being able to forget. And I think that's why you have Yonsei, Gosei, fourth and fifth generation Japanese Americans, like Tracy and Tina, that, you know, were a generation beyond camp. You know, I wasn't in camp, but they were generations beyond camp. And, you know, that they are here to tell these stories, that Tina is here to tell Jito's story that would never have gotten told, never, had she not uncovered it. So, you know, once again, I think the stories are changing.
So I can take this opportunity to answer a question that came in through the Q&A, which was about how I first came across Jiro Onuma's materials. So I was invited by the artist E.G. Crichton, who's based in the San Francisco Bay Area. She was an artist in residence at the GLBT Historical Society, which is similar to the One Archives in Los Angeles. E.G. Crichton had gone through the archival collection and found a number of personal collections of people that she thought were really interesting, but weren't famous at all. And then she asked a number of artists, writers, poets, musicians to respond to the individual collections. She called the project Lineage Matchmaking in the Archive. And she really thought of it as a kind of like queer romantic matchmaking project. So the person I was matched with was Jiro Onuma, and that's what sort of opened the door for me. Since then, I mean, so many people are doing great work in this area. And earlier, I put in the chat a link to the online exhibition, Seen and Unseen, Queering JA History Before 1945. So for those of you who are interested in looking at archival materials that tell this queer story, our queer story, please check out that exhibition. And there's also events attached to that as well.
Thanks so much, Tina. We have 2 minutes left, and I was told that we should be wrapping, but I just wanted to give the panelists an opportunity to offer 3 words of inspiration. especially with regard to what's happening with mass incarceration of brown and black folks and of immigrants. Can you offer one, two, three words of inspiration on how we can engage and how we can act?
Okay, I got three.
All right.
Resist, act, dream.
That's good.
Show up robustly.
Vigilance and grit.
That's great.
No more silence.
That's so good. Thank you so much. I'm getting chills all over. So I'd like to thank everybody, Nancy, Karen, Tina, and Trey for being our wonderful panelists today. I feel like I barely need to moderate the conversation. It was so productive and gave me so many ideas about how we can interact archives with activism, with art, through art. Hope to be able to continue the conversation and the stream of practices that you're offering for the world. And thank you to Lexi and Addy for providing the support on the back end and organizing the event. Such a needed conversation for now at the moment. And I just also thank you to all the audience members who decided to register and be a part of this conversation Monday after a really, really busy and hectic week. And hopefully we can find moments of solidarity and healing and continue to do so after this. Lexi, did you want to hop on and just say a few final words for everyone? Or Addy?
Come on. No, I mean, I echo everything that's already been said. Just an immense gratitude for everyone to be here and share such stories, their own work, hopefully in those last three words, which were tough, Umi, but inspiring as a word to continue working and fighting and striving for a better future and learning every day. So I think that's all we got. We're ending extremely punctually this evening. And I thank everyone for joining and being part, and the work continues.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks everyone. Good night. Thank you.